for I walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you, dear friends. Welcome back to our fourth session of this series of the phrase, But God, written by Reverend Ian Gordon of the Jesus But Nothing Bible Study Series. The next example that we're going to explore comes in the life of David. It comes during difficult times when he was under attack and on the run. Hiding, fighting, running some more, unsure what today will hold, let alone tomorrow. But God was with him. There was an unseen hand protecting him. I want to focus on this because we as Christians also live in difficult days. The enemy is stirring up a lot of trouble. Lawlessness is increasing. The old established order is changing rapidly. The church is increasingly coming under attack. Christians are finding that they live in a society that is becoming intolerant towards the beliefs we hold. It is easy to feel more isolated. It's easy to feel concerned about what is coming. But through it all is the unseen protective hand of God, just as it was in the days of David. So we will look at this protective hand of God today. We'll start with a general overview of how the Bible pictures God's protection. We look at the Old Testament story concerning the life of David, contrasting the hands of Saul and of God. We'll explore what the Bible says concerning the power of the hand of God. We'll conclude with an application paralleling David's experience and ours today. So let's dive in with an overview of how the Bible pictures the protection of God. Can you think of any image used in the Bible to speak of the invisible protection that enfolds the believer? Was there something about a hedge? Yes, I knew you would get it. Let's look into some of these. First, a hedge. Job chapter 1, verse 10. Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything that he has? You have blessed his work, the work of his hands, so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. In this verse, Satan complained that God has placed a hedge around Jacob, around Job and his family. The word hedge means to fence in. It refers to erecting a protective or restraining barrier. God has placed a restraining barrier around Job and his household, which Satan was powerless to do anything about. For a rebellious Israel, the Bible also speaks of this hedge being removed for a season so that their enemies could overcome them. We see this in Isaiah chapter 5, verse 3 to 5. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done it? Why, when I expected it to produce good grapes, did it produce worthless ones? So now, let me tell you what I'm going to do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge. It will be consumed. I will break down its wall and it will become trampled ground. The second imagery is an encampment. In Psalm 34, verse 67, this poor man cried and the Lord heard him and he saved him out of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and rescues them. Here the Bible tells us that the angel of the Lord, a term often used for the Lord Jesus in the Old Testament, encamps around those that fear him. This word encamps has the Hebrew meaning of abides with or pitches his tent. And this is done around the believer. With this word translated around, meaning to encircle or to be on every side. So the one who fears the Lord is protected on every side by the presence of him who dwells or pitches his tent with the believer. There is no sneaking up from behind on such a God. The third imagery, a seal. We read in Revelations chapter 9, verse 3 to 4. And out of the smoke, locusts came upon the earth and were given power like that of scorpions of the earth. They were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any plant or tree, but only those people who did not have the seal of God on their foreheads. Revelation gives us a glimpse of demonic spirits seen as locusts. They have the power to strike and inflict pain on humankind in the last days. Yet they are not allowed to touch those with the seal of God on their foreheads. The word seal means to impress as a guarantee of genuineness. Yet again, we see the keeping and protective power of God. Even the enemy, out to strike humanity, has to follow God's decree. They cannot touch those who have his seal, his sign of genuineness, his ownership upon his people. The fourth image is a shield. Genesis chapter 15, verse 1, we read, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, saying, do not fear, Abraham. I am a shield to you. Your reward shall be very great. The Bible often speaks of God as a shield for the believer. In Judges chapter 5, verse 8, in 2 Samuel 1, verse 21, in 1 Kings 14, verse 27, Job 15, verse 26, just as he was for Abraham. The Hebrew word is also used of the protective scales of a crocodile in Job chapter 41, verse 15. Just some trivial information that I thought you'd like to know. The fifth is a God. 1 Peter 1, verse 3 to 5, we read, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and not fading and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected, guarded, by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. The Greek word translated protected here as the thought of a sentinel or tower guard, a watcher. It speaks of him who keeps watch by day or by night with nothing escaping his gaze. In Psalm 121, we read that, don't we? Does it not calm those fears when we realize that the Almighty God is standing guard as a watchman over the affairs of our lives? It is the same word that is translated God in Philippians 4, verse 6 to 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, we see in verse 7. So God can guard our hearts, bringing peace from the fears and worries that strike in this life. That, of course, occurs as we follow what he said in the preceding verse, in verse 6. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, Let your requests be known to God. Dear friends, because of our faith, we are protected by the power of God, as Scripture says. Let us now look at King David and his but God story. It is found in 1 Samuel 23, verses 1 to 14. We start with 1 Samuel 23, verse 1 to 5. When David was told, "Look, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are looting the threshing floors," he inquired of the Lord, saying, "Shall I go and attack those Philistines?" The Lord answered him, "Go attack the Philistines and save Keilah." But David's men said to him, "Here in Judah we are afraid. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the Philistine forces?" Once again David inquired of the Lord, and the Lord answered him, "Go down to Keilah, for I'm going to give the Philistines into your hand." So David and his men went to Keilah, fought the Philistines, and carried off their livestock, inflicted heavy losses on the Philistines, and saved the people of Keilah. The context of the story takes place while David and his men are on the run from a crazed King Saul. They've been running, hiding, and running some more. Life isn't easy. While it would be tempting to just think of yourself in such a time, David is not like that. Hearing that Keilah, a city in the lowlands of Judah, is under attack from the Philistines, David asks the Lord if he should go and help. The Lord says, "Yes." But David's own men are saying, "Steady on there, chief. Haven't we got enough problems of our own?" David's men are not keen, already fearful from the hostility experienced from Saul. So David asks the Lord a second time, and again it's the same. "Go down. I will give you victory." So that is what David and his trembling men do. And he saved the people of Keilah through the great victory that the Lord gave them. So far, so good. But here comes Saul. We continue in verse 7. Saul was told that David had gone to Keilah, and he said, "God has handed him over to me, for David has imprisoned himself by entering a town with gates and bars." And Saul called up his forces for battle to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. When David learned that Saul was plotting against him, he said to Abiathar the priest, "Bring the ephod." David said, "O Lord, God of Israel, your servant has heard definitely that Saul plans to come to Keilah and destroy the town on account of me. Will the citizens of Keilah surrender me to him? Will Saul come down as your servant has heard? O Lord, God of Israel, tell your servant." And the Lord said, "He will." Again David asked, "Will the citizens of Keilah surrender me and my men to Saul?" And the Lord said, "They will." So hearing this, and that David had gone to Keilah, Saul thinks that this is a perfect opportunity to finally capture David. And for some strange reason, Saul even thinks that God is on his side in this. Talk about deluded. That is what happens when God gives someone over. They can't even see how deceived they are. But never fear. David is safe in Keilah because, having just saved the entire city from the hands of the Philistines, they love him and would protect him even to the point of death. Right? Well, actually, no. As David inquires of the Lord confirms that Saul is indeed coming, and the people of Keilah are going to hand him over to Saul. Not a lot of loyalty or support from his fellow Jews here. We continue in verse 13 to 14. So David and his men, about 600 in number, left Keilah and kept moving from place to place. When Saul was told that David had escaped from Keilah, he did not go there. David stayed in the desert strongholds and in the hills of the desert of Ziph. Day after day, Saul searched for him, but God did not give David into his hands. And so the running and the hiding continues, friends. Moving from place to place in the desert of Ziph, David and his men remained on the run from Saul. The Bible says, day after day, Saul searched for him, but God did not give David into his hand. Now, how strong was the hand of Saul? Let's not underestimate it, friends. He was demonically oppressed king of Israel. He rules in a dictatorship. Anything he says goes. And in verse 8, the Bible tells us he had come to capture David with all his forces. The hand of Saul, is strong indeed. He has his army. He has vast resources and the people willing to turn David in. Yes, the hand of Saul is strong indeed, but God did not give David into his hands. God was the greater hand. Think for a moment. Would it have mattered how many Saul had looking for David? Would it have mattered how long they looked for? Would it have mattered how many rats, moles, and spies Saul had at his disposal, willing to do David in? No, friends, it wouldn't have, because Saul had an unseen problem that was stopping his search from being successful. God, the unseen protective hand of God, was far stronger than the seen destructive hand of Saul. So what are you currently fearful of, friends? Have you also seen the unseen protective hand of God working in your lives? Let's just pause and think about God's hand and power for a moment. The hand of God is often expressed in relation to his power. Meditate on the following verses that mention the hand of God. Firstly, there's the creative power. In Isaiah 48, verse 13, it was my hand that laid the foundations of the earth, my right hand that spread out the heavens above. And then the sustaining power in Job chapter 12, verse 9 to 10. Which of these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this? In his hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind. Then there's the guiding power in Psalm 139, verse 10. Your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. And then there's a strengthening power, Isaiah 41, verse 10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Then the upholding power in Psalm 37, 23 to 24. The steps of a man are established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. When he falls, he will not be hurled headlong, because the Lord is the one who holds his hand. And lastly, the saving power. John chapter 10, verse 27 to 29. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall not perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. In Isaiah chapter 49, verse 16, God said to the nation of Israel, "Behold, I have graven thee upon the palm of my hands." This brings to mind, does it not, our Savior, who has an ever reminder of those that are his and what it cost upon his nail-scarred hands there on the cross of Calvary. We read in Revelations 5, verse 6, "Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. The great high priest, whose name is Love, whoever lives and pleads for me, my name is graven on his hands. My name is written in his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart." So why the troubles? If we are protected under the all-powerful hand of God, so how come so many difficulties still come our way, you may ask, friends? That's a fair question. We need to remember that the same hand that protects also shapes and molds. He is the protector, but also the master potter. He presses his thumbs and fingers into spots that can hurt to shape and design as he wills, but for our good. In Isaiah chapter 64, verse 8 on our screen. "But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are the work of your hand." And also on our screen, Jeremiah 18, verse 6. "O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter, says the Lord? Look at the clay. Look, as the clay is in the potter's hands, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel." So though under the protective hand of God, friends, he allows circumstances that try and refine us for our good. He If you just think that God is there to smooth out every road, calm every sea, ease every wind, and make life easy, I'm sorry to report that you have a very limited, even unbiblical view of God. So how did David feel during this time? Let's go back to the story of David. It is important not to just gloss over how David felt during this time in the desert areas of Ziph. They was always under the unseen protective hand of God. That doesn't mean that things were a walk in the park. It doesn't even mean that David knew how things would turn out. There's even some instruction in the name of Ziph, which according to a dictionary of scripture proper names means melting. An associated word, Ziphah, means refinery. In this regard, Arno Gabelin writes, "In the wilderness of Ziph, Saul sought him every day, but God did not deliver him into his hands. And David learned by experience that the name of Ziph means, it means refining. In a refining process of suffering and endurance, the shepherd king was fitted for his coming exaltation." The refining of David is seen in many of his psalms that he wrote during this period. Psalm 18, Psalm 34, 52, 59, and 142 are all written during this time of hiding and running from Saul. Let's look at one of these. Psalm 18 gives us both in poetic and prophetic imagery David's experience, both before and after his deliverance from Saul's hand. Verse 1 to 6, "For the director of music of David, the servant of the Lord, he sang to the Lord the words of this song when the Lord delivered him from the hands of his enemies and from the hand of Saul. He said, 'I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I'm saved from my enemies. The cords of death entangle me. The torrents of destruction overwhelm me. The cords of the grave have coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears.'" So friends, here we see in very rich imagery how David felt. The cords of death had entangled him and were pulling him down. The cords of the grave were wrapping ever around him and dragging him into death. That is how David felt. Constantly having to run, hide, and fight for your life takes its toll. His own strength and resources were not enough for David, so he cries out to the Lord. And then we continue verse 7 to 19. "The earth trembled and quaked, and the foundations of the mountains shook. They trembled because he was angry. Smoke rose from his nostrils. Consuming fire came from his mouth. Burning coals blazed out of it. He parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under his feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. He made darkness his covering, his canopy around him, the dark rain clouds of the sky. Out of the brightness, his presence, clouds advanced with hailstones and bolts of lightning. The Lord thundered from heaven. The voice of the Most High resounded. He shot his arrows and scattered the enemies. Great bolts of lightning had routed them. The valleys of the sea were exposed, and the foundations of the earth lay bare at your rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of breath from your nostrils. He reached down from on high and took hold of me, and he drew me out of the deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of the disaster, but the Lord was my support. He brought me out into a spacious place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. Dear friends, these are poetic and important prophetic words which show the Lord rising and coming to David's rescue. Only God could save him here from enemies too powerful for David. They confronted me on the day of my disaster, but the Lord was my support. And what a support that is. The word translated support is a masculine noun designated a staff, a support, a supply. It indicates something serving to firm, to keep stable. God was David's stay when all seemed lost. Now, while Psalm 18 is poetic in its language, I also mentioned it's also prophetic. The language given of the earth trembling and quaking at the anger of the Lord as he splits the heavens and comes down to confront David's enemy is poetic for the days of David, but prophetic of what will take place at the end of the tribulation when the Lord himself will actually descend to protect Israel and destroy his enemies. It is worth reading Psalm 18, verse 6 to 18, with the end times in mind. Like David in his distress, the nation of Israel will call for their Messiah to come, and come he will. So in conclusion, friends, now I'm sure you have noticed the similarities between David's day and our own. Even the place that David and Christianity had within the society seems similar. In the early days, David was accepted and loved within Saul's kingdom. He had conquered Goliath and Israel prospered because of him. He was given a seat with the king in 1 Samuel 18 verse 2 we read, and was successful in all that he did in 1 Samuel 18 verse 5. But in time, Saul's jealousy and hatred of David grew as an evil spirit affected Saul in verse 10. David went from being a golden boy and loved in the kingdom to being despised by a partially mad king. Soon, unexpected spears were getting thrown in his way in verse 11. Before long, David and his men are not welcome and all within the kingdom were driven out. Friends, I don't think it's too much of a stretch to see that Christianity within Western society has become like that. The church was seen as an integral part of society, shaping how people thought. Our Western society is founded on Judeo-Christian beliefs. The church was respected. Our society flourished and prospered, just as they did when David was honored within Israel. But over time, things changed. Over time, the spears came out. Soon they were directed at Christians and their beliefs. Maybe you have noticed the increased hatred and antagonism. The biblical message of Jesus being the only way of salvation is largely despised in a day where everything now has to be politically correct. The biblical message of God ordaining marriage to be between a husband and wife is shamed today. Too narrow, too bigoted, too exclusive. The sanctity of life, especially for the unborn, has been tragically discarded. You can have an abortion on demand. It's no longer illegal. In many countries, hate laws are increasing, which often target Christian beliefs. There are more spears, more driving out from society of that which made the society strong to begin with, all in the name of being progressive, just as an evil spirit came upon Saul and everything changed within the kingdom. So there has been a giving over to a depraved mind, which blinds many from even seeing the destructive that their progressive values cause. Go and read Romans 1 verse 8 to 32 about this. So things become difficult for David, but God was with him and he did not give him into the hands of Saul. God's hand was greater. As believers today, we look to the blessed hope, the coming of the Lord who rescues us, according to 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 10, from the wrath to come. We see the signs of the nearness of his coming. We do not know how much change, trial, and general tribulation there will be before that day arrives. But what I do know, dear friends, is that the believer is loved, cared for, and kept under the protective, unseen hand of God. So whatever change comes into this world in 2021 with the COVID-19 pandemic has just been a foretaste of the crazy changes ahead. Do not forget, dear friends, do not take your eyes off the "but God" aspect. Always look to see with the eyes of faith the unseen hand of God at work in your lives. He is your stay. He is your staff. He is your support. He is your supply. Let us pray. Dear God, you are our blessed hope. Help us to withstand the wrath to come. We see the signs of the nearness of your coming, but do not know how much change, trial, and general tribulation there will be. But Lord, we look to your loving, caring, protective hand on our lives. So whatever changes come in 2021 with this COVID-19 pandemic, this third wave that's upon us, this has just been a foretaste, Lord, of the things that will still come. But do not let us forget. Do not let us take our eyes off the "but God" aspect. And let us look and see with the eyes of faith the unseen hand of God. Dear friends, thank you for being with me today. And I look forward to being with you next week. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.